Hello and welcome to the broadband edition of WION Sports. With me, Digvijay, Singh. Now, the coronavirus pandemic has taken out the entire global sporting calendar, but more bad news keeps coming in. The Olympics have already been postponed, but now iconic sporting tournaments are falling by the wayside. First, it was the Augusta Masters, then it was the Monaco GP, and now it's the most prestigious tennis Grand Slam, Wimbledon, which has announced that it will be cancelled for this year and not postponed. I am joined by Mahesh Bhupathi, one of the icons of Indian sport and who himself won 3 Wimbledon titles. Mahesh, your first reaction to the cancellation of Wimbledon, sad or inevitable?
Well, I think, you know, as a tennis fan, heartbroken. Tennis, Wimbledon's always been the epicenter of our sport. And, for me, even since I've been retired, I've spent every summer in London and been to the matches. So, heartbroken that Wimbledon will not be played this year. But obviously, I think, some perspective to what the world is going through and how serious this virus is, and hopefully there will be a bounce back very soon.
Okay, I'm going to play devil's advocate here, so please allow me some leeway here, because we are right now in the first week of April, and Wimbledon was scheduled to start at the end of June, so that's about give or take 3 months. That's what a lot of people are saying. Even the likes of Boris Becker was saying, hang on, don't rush into the decision. That's what I'm also asking you. Have they rushed it a bit too early? Could they have waited any more?
I doubt it. I mean, see, I'll give you a sense of the kind of revenue these Grand Slams make over 2 weeks. I think these four events are the largest sporting events in the world if you take it by the kind of time they're played, versus a Premier League that's, over 6 months or so. So when they take decisions, everyone is consulted. And personally, I know a bunch of friends in London who have contracted the disease. Unfortunately, I think it's only going to get worse. So I think Wimbledon took the right call because, staging an event of that magnitude involves a lot of preparation. Like they said, training ball kids from across different countries. I mean, all this has to be factored in. And, if Wimbledon, that are always meticulous and perfect about what they do, if they can't get it right, I'm sure that they didn't want to, do a shabby job.
Okay, but I'm going to continue down this this route. I'm actually going down, Mahesh, because, there also existed the possibility. And when I read that Wimbledon statement last night, which you also probably read, it said that, we can't have these crowds, but there existed the possibility of playing behind closed doors. Now, that's not ideal. Let's face it. It's not ideal playing Wimbledon in an empty center court. But there are people out there, like the England captain, Owen Morgan, the cricket captain, who is saying that currently the way the world is, perhaps playing behind closed doors and telecasting sporting events will give people some kind of hope. There was that option. Wimbledon, we all know, sticklers for tradition, and maybe that's why they didn't want to go down and not play behind closed doors.
Look, I don't think that's fair on the players. I think, part of the atmosphere of playing at any event, forget about these big events, is packed houses, packed crowds, and that's when you play your best tennis and you enjoy the big matches and the tough five set battles that you have. So playing behind closed doors, I mean, how many people are you going to put at risk, right? I mean, you're thinking about empty stadiums, but the players are out there, the umpires are out there, the linesmen are out there. You have to have some kind of organizational staff on ground. So I don't think it's fair to say we'll protect the spectators, but we'll put the rest in harm's way just to get some TV revenue.
Okay, that's a fair point. But predictably, as you also mentioned, lots of reactions coming in from players. The great Martina has spoken this morning. Tweets coming in from the likes of Federer, Serena, and everyone's pretty disappointed. What was it about Wimbledon, Mahesh? You spent a lot of time there, as you mentioned. What is it about Wimbledon that makes it the go-to event on the tennis calendar? There's the French Open, you have the Australian Open, US Open as well. You have Indian Wells, which, people say is a fifth major. But what is it about Wimbledon? What makes it so special to players?
Yeah, Wimbledon has always been, and I think always will be, the mecca of tennis. I mean, that is where the tennis world congregates once in a year. You know, if you walk around the ground or the players lounge or, you know, the business areas at Wimbledon, you will see all the other Grand Slams there, every single tennis agent, every single manufacturer. So it's really kind of a celebration of tennis. And, you know, that's what I think everyone's going to miss. But like I said, I mean, you know, in today's time, I think health and, you know, family is the priority.
You know, you can't control Father Time as well. You know, two reactions on Twitter which have got the most number of retweets and kind of people quoting it are the ones from Roger Federer and Serena Williams. You know, when you looked at where they were going in their careers, you would have thought that Wimbledon was perhaps the best place for them to add to that major hall. And with one more year, it sort of gets difficult, doesn't it? Especially when you are in reaching the wrong side of the 30s.
Yes, I think, you know, what the virus has done over the last few months and probably will continue to do for the rest of the season is going to be fairly significant when it comes to rewriting the history books in our sport. We all know the race is very tight between Roger, Rafa and Novak. You know, we know Wimbledon was his best opportunity surface-wise to pick up another slam, to distance himself. You know, Serena has been so close to getting that record. And, you know, again, Wimbledon is by far her favorite surface. So, you know, unfortunately, yeah, for both of them, I mean, I think as tennis fans, we all hope that they'll be back playing their best next year this time. But I think, you know, when we look down the road, maybe 10 years down the line, I think this break could be a significant chapter in, you know, the history books.
Yes, it's an important point you make. But talking of Federer, I saw his tweet yesterday. You know, it was snowing. He was probably somewhere in Switzerland trying to, you know, play some trick shots. And it's good to see him back because he took a break to have surgery. And it's actually worked out pretty well for him because the tennis season suspended. He's not losing any ranking points. He wanted to play the Olympics this year as well. You do get a feeling looking at the way things are panning out. And as you said, looking at how this rivalry is going on between the race for the Grand Slam, that the next year, 2021, if he decides to commit to it, could be the last time we see Roger Federer. I mean, don't see him moving on beyond that. I mean, you know, could end Olympics, US Open, that's it.
You know, I've learned the easy and the hard way over the last few years not to write off Roger Federer.
You know, I'm not writing him off.
So, you know, people said 4 years ago, this could be Roger's last slam. They said this could be Roger's last year, but, you know, he has this amazing ability to play 10 or 12 tournaments a year and play at the highest level. So, again, that's partly God's gift. So, I won't be surprised if he plays, you know, as long as a couple or 2-3 years. But, you know, I think everyone, all the tennis players are getting a little restless because, you know, we've not known something like this to stay at home and, you know, not be able to train, not be able to get on the tennis court. It's frustrating all around.
Yeah, and that's the question I was going to ask you, Mahesh, because, you know, there are some people who are already saying that probably the tennis 2020 tennis season is already over, because while there are some who can be at home and who have access to tennis courts, not everyone has, and you can't build up your fitness, you know, by just hitting the gym. Even if you have a gym at home or doing all sorts of exercises, you need to be out there playing, and when you don't have that, it sort of gets difficult for most players.
Yeah, it's very difficult. I mean, when you lose your cardio conditioning, building that is not, you know, an overnight's job. So I'm not sure the season is over. I don't know, you know, as this flattens out and, you know, subsides, I'm pretty sure that the off season is definitely going to be cancelled and the ATP and the WTA will try and put as many events on at the end of the year as they can. Because, you know, tennis players don't get paid if they don't play. And, you know, we all know that the top players make a lot of money. But, you know, anyone below 50, they're not getting any income. You know, their coaches are not making money. The commentators are not making money. So there's a whole ecosystem around every sport that's kind of at a standstill. And I think the ATP and the WTA have to kind of, you know, quickly figure things out for these guys.
Yeah, that's something I wanted to ask you, because I saw a tweet from you. You'd actually, you know, interact a lot with the Indian tennis players as well. Not all of them are millionaires. Not all of them have substantial savings. You put out a tweet, I think, yesterday or day before with all of you, including the likes of Somdev and all who have retired, getting together and just talking about what can happen, what should happen. How difficult is it for the players, you know, because a lot of them, even play on the challenger tours or go down to the ITF circuit where it's not the millions, you know, you play for something like $2,000-$3,000. It's as basic as that, but that's how their livelihoods happen.
Yeah, that's what I said. It's a very challenging time for the players who are below 50. Forget about who are ranked 200 and 300 in the world, because there's absolutely no income. I think some of them are like, you know, Sumit is currently in Germany, and I'm sure he's raking up costs every week because of where he's staying and at his academy, and they, you know, there's no money to be made. So I don't know what the right answer is, but I'm sure the tours are, you know, working out something to figure it out, because there has been a significant contribution to all the pension plans for the last few years. So I think if the ATP kind of, you know, declare force majeure, I think there is a way to get some money and get it into the players' hands, which I think is very important.
Well, that's pretty interesting, because I was going to ask you that, is there anything, you know, is there anything that the ITF or the WTA or the ATP can do? Because again, you know, we have seen the big players like the Nadals, the Federers and the Djokovics of the world contributing money to for relief work. But there is also now talk, if you see in Germany, in German football or English football, a lot of clubs, even Spanish football, they have decided that, yes, these players get paid a lot of money. So they're taking pay cuts in order to pay the other essential staff. And because tennis is such a professional sport, Mahesh, governments aren't going to help players as well. I mean, you can have it in other countries, perhaps, but if you're a professional player, then it's up to you how you handle this. It's like everybody else in the world right now who's professional.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's even worse than that, because, you know, if you know, you're working for a company, you've got a lot of companies and owners of companies that are standing by their employees and guaranteeing their jobs, even if there's a little pay cut, you know, just to tide over the frustrations. But, you know, when tennis is concerned, it's an individual sport. You're not employed by anyone, and you're literally not getting a paycheck. So unless, like I said, the ATP and the WTA need to figure things out for their players quickly, otherwise, you know, there will be, you know, more than just frustration in a few months.
Yes, sir. No, you said that, you know, they have to work something out because it has to resume. When it does resume, we're already looking at a big clash. Now, Wimbledon didn't postpone. Wimbledon cancelled. But you have a situation now of the French Open unilaterally going to September after the US Open. Roger Federer's Laver Cup is on at that point of time. The Laver Cup has tweeted out at that point of time saying, we're going to be on. Do you foresee a situation where top players actually skip the French Open and play the Laver Cup? It's not something we've seen in this era of tennis, of players skipping Grand Slams. What do you do?
Honestly, if things get better by then, I'm sure they will come to a compromise. I definitely do not see any top players skipping the French Open to play Wimbledon, also because of the race we just spoke about to get to the number one spot in number of slams won. I mean, if anyone skips it, it would be Roger, because he, you know, is kind of involved in Laver Cup in many ways. But other than that, there has to be a compromise. You know, I think everybody is renegotiating whatever they've committed to long term. And I think that's the way the world is going forward.
Yeah, because, you know, when it comes to tournaments, at least they could have, some of them would have backing from sponsors. Some of them can rely on the insurance. Ultimately, that's a lot of other factors, as you said, from ball boys to getting paid to umpires and commentators, everyone moves in. For you personally, what's the schedule like during the lockdown, Mahesh? I've seen a few photos and videos of you heavy duty exercises on, lying on the floor. I don't know what you call it. I'm forgetting the name. Yeah.
What else? I need to be active at least once a day. You know, obviously, we've got an 8-year-old at home, so we're trying to keep her entertained as the whole day, which is not easy because, you know, it's 15 days at home and she's really dying to get back to school. Luckily for us, school starts online on Monday, so half the day is taken care of. But yeah, I mean, just, you know, killing time, doing a little work, trying to catch up with as many friends and make sure everyone's okay. And yeah, that's about it.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that I can say, you know, we've had it better. Our son has been able to have his classes ever since this lockdown happened. So the first part of the morning, my wife's pretty happy because, you know, 8 in the morning, you put him into a room and those classes go on till post-lunch. So that way, yeah, you're right. Especially when you have a kid at home, it gets difficult. But you love your movies. I remember once upon a time, I don't know if you still have it, you had a email ID called Mahesh number one. So I'd once asked you, is it because you were number one in the world? You said, no, I was a big fan of the Govinda movies. So you love your movies. Binge watching anything of late, or because you're such a big lover, you've seen everything and there's nothing else to do, probably watch reruns?
Yeah, reruns. I mean, luckily the shows keep coming up, updating new seasons, so we keep binge watching everything. But as far as movies go, I know I saw Student of the Year again because my daughter wanted to see it. We saw Tanaji 2 days ago. We saw, yeah, it's a lot of reruns because these are the classics that I want, my daughter wants to watch. So I kind of sit and watch it with her.
Okay, I should probably recommend you to my friend Rajiv Masan. You both can exchange notes on movies after you watch them so much. But Mahesh, thank you so much for this. You know, I do understand that, you know, while we journalists are sort of jumpy, it's much more difficult for you, all of you sports persons are talking to all of them, and all of them just sort of just can't wait to get out because they're all so active, and just being cooped up at one place is the problem. But health and safety comes first. Thanks for giving me this time, and you know, all of you stay safe.
Thanks. You too, Riggy. Talk to you soon.